الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. قال تبارك وتعالى: لا تمدن عينيك إلى ما متعنا به أزواجا منهم زهرة الحياة الدنيا. Respected brothers, elders, mothers, sisters, and dear youngsters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, sustainer, and nourisher, and we send the choicest blessings upon the final messenger, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. They generally say when we look at a glass with water, we can either look at it as half full or half empty. And it's all about perspective. So inshallah, in these few moments that I have before me, I would like to talk a little about perspective and context. And this is a phenomenon, or it's a thought that we tend to stay away from. So we have issues, we have problems, we have difficulties, we have circumstances. But many times, by looking at the issue at hand simply from one perspective, we are unable to solve the problem or look at the bigger picture and address the matter. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, this is one of the narrations of Sahih Muslim. We also read it on Wednesday in the Hadith Halaqa. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu reports that one occasion, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him, qasama qasman, he distributed some wealth. And after distributing the wealth, Umar ibn al-Khattab said, I approached the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I said to him, la ghayru ha'ula'i kanu ahaqqu bihi minhum. I feel that, O Prophet of Allah, you have made the wrong judgment. You have made the wrong decision. Subhanallah, the openness in communication, this is something that we lack in our communities. We're unable to communicate. The younger ones are unable to communicate. Is it because we're so threatening? Is it because we're so authoritative? We're unable to express ourselves. Here's the companion Umar ibn al-Khattab speaking to the Prophet of Allah, peace and blessings upon him, and saying that I disagree with your judgment in how and who you have distributed this wealth to. Nevertheless, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, acknowledged his objection. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said that I looked at this issue from a different perspective. Umar ibn al-Khattab was looking at the immediate situation. The situation was such, as commentators explain, that these were people who had wealth. They were people who were not in need. So Umar ibn al-Khattab said that it's possible that you've made a wrong judgment and this wealth should have been distributed to another group of people who are far more in needy. أَحَقُّ بِهِمْ. They have more right in this wealth. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, responded by saying, إِنَّهُمْ خَيَّرُونِي. They have come to me to seek help. They have come to me to seek help. And I'm looking at the bigger picture. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, noticed that they had come to make a judgment about Islam. They were investigating about the Prophet of Allah, about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about Islam. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said to Umar ibn al-Khattab that they had come to investigate about Islam and its reality. And they were in a sense of this question, will this person give? Will the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, give? فَأُعْطِيَهُمْ أَوْ يُبَخِّلُونِي. Will I give, or will they have the ability or the opportunity to label me as a stingy person, as a miserly person? So I gave to them, with this vision in mind, that these people will have a perspective on Islam. They will have an understanding about Islam. And the other thing is, وَلَسْتُ بِبَاخِلْ. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, I am not a miserly person. I am not a person who's not generous. Yes, there may be other people who are far more in need, but here there's a different perspective. There's a different angle to it. So many times we face issues, but we only address the issue from a particular perspective. We don't have the bigger picture. Hence, we're unable to address the issue or the matter at hand. So one thing we need to realize and we need to do, which is actually an Islamic injunction. When the Sahaba, when the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum arrived from Mecca to Medina, there was relevant peace. It wasn't so difficult. There weren't as many issues. So some of the companions made some statements such as, there's no need to now go into campaigns. So Allah revealed the verses, عَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌّ لَكُمْ. You may like something, but the reality is it's evil for you. It's bad for you. وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا. You may dislike something. وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. But the reality, the real perspective is that there's khair. There's goodness for you in it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala summons you and I. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands that we look at things in different perspectives. Many times as human beings, our perspective is limited. Our perspective has boundaries. We're unable to see from our human perspective. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the real perspective. When some of the Sahaba and the companions, and rightfully so, they were also human beings. Many times we are under the impression the Sahaba were superstars. They were not human beings. But they were human beings. So they asked the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and many of us ask this question in our minds, that if we are on truth, if we are on success, if we are on the real message of Allah, of God, then why is it not that we are in a better situation than the disbelievers? Why are we going through struggles? Why are we going through challenges? Are we not on the truth? So they pointed out, the Sahaba pointed out, look at these individuals who are in disbelief, and they have so much. Their lives seem to be pretty, peaceful, great. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verses. Look at it from a different perspective. لَا تَمُدَّنَّ عَيْنَيْكَ إِلَى مَا مَتَّعْنَا بِهِ أَزْوَاجًا مِّنْهُمْ زَهْرَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't stretch your eyes at what they have, because مَتَّعْنَا, we have given them a little benefit. It's some pleasure of this world. But the real pleasure in this world and also in the next life is with those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about nations, towards the conclusion of the incident, the story or the events of the people of the past, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَانْظُرْ كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةً. Look at the end result. Look at the end result. Don't look at the beginning of their lives. Look at the end result. What happened to them? And where was their destination? A different perspective. So we face situations. We may be walking and we made salam, but the brother didn't make salam. So we automatically make judgments. But what do the pious say? Some people say this is a hadith of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. But those who study the details of the hadith of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, they say this is not a statement of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's the statement of the pious. So the pious people generally say that before we make an inappropriate judgment upon someone, make 70 excuses. 70 excuses. This person didn't make salam. Maybe he didn't hear me. Maybe I need to raise my voice. Maybe he had a bad day. He's just in some deep thoughts. My spouse didn't do what I expected her to do. Or my partner. Maybe there was a situation. Look at it from a different perspective. And we'll be able to challenge and also address the situations that we face on a daily basis. Many times when we talk to people of other faiths, okay, their question is, many times. You know, if Islam is a religion of peace, then why do we see chaos? Why do we see people in the name of Islam doing all of these things? And they take verses of the Holy Quran. They take statements of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him. So we talk about Islamophobia. So many times when we approach the situation, we tell them, you gotta look at everything from its real perspective, and its context, and from the right source. And I generally give the example that if I tell you that there's a child and someone is severing the finger of this child, someone is severing, cutting the finger of this child, how does it sound? So they all say, awful, horrific. But then I tell them, if I tell you that this is happening in the hospital up the road, Scarborough General Hospital, and there are surgeons, there are medical professionals who have made a decision after diagnosing the situation that there's a venomous form of cancer in this finger of the child. And if this finger is not severed through medical research, they can come to a conclusion that this venomous cancer will spread throughout the body and this will lead to the death of this child. Now, it makes sense. It's put into context. It's from the proper perspective. So we talk about others using the verses of the Quran, but the reality is many times the problems within our families, within our communities, is because we don't look at the verses from its true perspective. So, for example, the verses of the Quran speak about the respect and the honor of parents. And there's no doubt, there's a very high status for parents. The young ones who are here, we need to understand that our parents have a status. After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the status is that of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. And then Allah mentions in the verse, is وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Serve parents, respect them, honor them. So there's no doubt in this. But, you know, I'm just returning from a counseling training session in Winnipeg that many imams and community leaders took. And they're coming through real data. They're saying there's a lot of abuse that is going on within our communities, in couples, with the young ones, different forms of abuse. And it's through statistics that a person who is very close to another, they generally, this is the first person who commits the abuse. So there are many cases of abuse, but when they address them, people are taking verses and hadith out of context to either abuse or not to report the abuse. So there are verses of the Quran that speak about respect to parents, but if a parent is abusing, if a parent is doing something that is totally against the teachings of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, and the verses of the Quran, there's nothing wrong in seeking help, even though it may be against the parent. Because it's to better the situation. It's to better the situation. لَا طَاعَةَ لِمَخْلُوقٍ فِي مَعْصِيَةِ الْخَالِقِ. There is no obedience to the creation when it's against the Creator. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a way. We have to look at these texts in perspectives. We talk about others. Okay, we talk about others, but there's a lot of issues in our own communities from the same perspective. So we talk about Islamophobia. We talk about, there's an article that just was released this week about a survey that was taken about the increase. Islam is the fastest growing religion in the United States. And they're saying there are approximately 2,000 masajid, mosques across the United States. Fastest growing religion. So definitely this is positive and we should be proud of it. We should be proud of it. We should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this is the situation of Islam despite the negative situations. But then we got to look into ourselves. Are we a strong majority or are we a weak majority? Quality and quantity, that's what it is. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, addressing this aspect, he said, He said, there will be a time, يُوشِكُ الْأُمَمُ أَن تَدَاعَ عَلَيْكُمْ كَمَا تَدَاعَ الْأَكَلَةُ إِلَىٰ قَصْعَتِهَا. A time will come where people will come together, different backgrounds, different races, different perspectives, they'll all come together against Islam. And the narration is lengthy, but towards the end, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, بَلْ أَنْتُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ كَثِيرٌ. When the companions asked, will the Muslims be in a minority? Will they be small in number? And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum were told that no, on that day, when these challenges will be happening, the Muslims will be in huge numbers. There will be a great populations of them. But then he didn't leave it at that. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, gave the solution. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, the reason for the decline despite the numbers is two things. حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا وَكَرَاهِيَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Intense love for the material of this world. When our objective in life is only wealth, then there's a problem. When our objective in this world is only wealth, then we will see problems in our families. We will see issues with our children. We will see communities. We will see nations destroyed when this is the only objective. حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا وَكَرَاهِيَةُ الْمَوْتِ. And hatred for death. People say, don't talk about death. People say, don't talk about death. We're scared to die. We're scared to die because we haven't prepared for death. We haven't prepared for death. I'm not living as a true believer. So I how can I face my Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So we need to take things in their proper perspectives. There's no issue about earning wealth, excelling in the worldly positions, and being at the forefront, but not at the compromise of our values. Not at the compromise of the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the teachings of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. One of my teachers just emailed me a really nice statement on the topic of death. He said, death will be a very rude awakening. Death will be a very rude awakening for those who have been sleepwalking all their lives. If we're sleepwalking, we're ignoring our values and our teachings, then we're sleepwalking. And then when we sleep, when we die, that's when we're going to really be awakened. So do we want a rude awakening or do we want a good awakening? So coming back to perspective, we got to look at things in different ways. And when we look at things in different ways from different angles, we will be able to find the solution. In a narration of Sahih Muslim, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, encourages this. He talks about total opposites. He talks about total opposites, but they're from a different perspective. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, مَا نَقَصَتْ صَدَقَةٌ مِّن مَالٍ. When you give charity, your wealth does not decrease. They're total opposite. We give charity, we're thinking, our perspective is, how am I going to pay my cell phone bill? How am I going to buy what I have intended to buy? But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, look at it from a different perspective. Allah will bless that wealth. Allah will give barakah. Allah will multiply. Allah will give manyfold. Then the narration continues. Generally we only hear this part. But the narration continues. مَا زَادَ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا بِعَفْوٍ إِلَّا عِزَّةٍ. When someone harms you, is doing wrong to you, and they ask for forgiveness, and you forgive them, then your honor is elevated. So apparently, when we forgive, it looks like we've humbled. We've humiliated ourselves. But the Prophet ﷺ says, look at it from a different perspective. And then the narration continues, مَا تَوَاضَعَ أَحَدٌ لِلَّهِ إِلَّا رَفَعَهُ اللَّهِ. The person who humbles themselves, they're not full of their ego. They don't make judgments on their ego. They humble themselves. Different perspective. Allah will elevate them. The Prophet ﷺ says, Allah will give them honor. So that person who you don't want to speak to, that family member that you're breaking ties with, those friends that you have abandoned, you know, go back to them. Ask forgiveness. Lower yourselves. Humble yourselves. We need to humble ourselves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will elevate us. So most certainly, we need to look at things from different perspectives. When the Nobel Prize, Peace Prize winner, Sister Tawakkul of Yemen, they say that the Yemeni revolution happened because some of her efforts. Nevertheless, she was asked about hijab. It was an academic crowd. It was a materialistic crowd. Many people without faith. And they asked her the question, doesn't your hijab not put you in a position that you're wearing a hijab and you have this Nobel Peace Prize and you're into, you know, all these different activities. Is it not a deterrent? Doesn't it seem like it's oppression? Doesn't it seem like it's negative? She presented her perspective. We're talking about perspective. She said, when humanity evolved, when they came first, they were nude. They had barely any clothing. As we evolved academically, as we evolved culturally, as we evolved, I'm paraphrasing, in different ways, she says, we came to a position where we started covering ourselves. Now, if we go back, we are regressing. If we take these things off, if we make ourselves bare, we're regressing. So, hijab is a sign of progress. It's a perspective of progress. It's a perspective of betterment. It's not a decline. And here's a living proof. Here's a living proof of a young woman who's at the forefront, standing up for justice, doing what is good. So we need to look at things from different perspectives. This is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We make dua that Allah bless us with the ability to do this. May Allah solve all our problems and our issues. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite our hearts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help those who suffer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us in our perspectives in every angle. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us success in this world and the everlasting life of the hereafter. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alamin.